Welcome to the third lesson of an intense course designed to help you learn Affinity Photo fast. In this video, we'll look at a few of the many tools in the Affinity Photo tools palette and how to use them. As with the first two lessons in the course, we only cover the essentials because you don't need to know all the tools. But it does mean you mustn't skip ahead or you'll miss something important. If you haven't already watched the first two lessons of this course, I'd recommend you watch them before continuing. I've included a link to them in the YouTube information for this video. When you open Affinity Photo, you'll see the tools arranged in the panel on the left of the screen. This is the tools palette in the photo persona. If we switch to a different persona, you'll see a different set of tools. Each persona displays the tools that are suited to helping you work in that persona. Because most of our editing is being done in the photo persona, we'll be looking at those tools. If I double-click below the palette, you can see that it opens as a floating toolbar, which I can then move around the screen. If I want to put the panel back in the sidebar, I can double-click the panel title. Now, it is possible that your version of Affinity Photo will display different tools to mine. One of the reasons for this is that you can customize the tools in the palette. You can do this by clicking the View menu and then the Customize Tools option. This opens a dialog where you can click and drag tool icons to add them or remove them from the panel. To ensure you have the same tools displayed as I have, click the Reset button at the bottom of the panel. You can then click the Close button. You select the tool that you want to use by clicking its icon with your mouse. When I hover my mouse over a tool icon, you can see a tooltip appears with the name of that tool. You can also see there's a letter in a square bracket after the tool name. This letter is a shortcut key to selecting that tool. For example, when I press the M key on my keyboard, it selects the Marquee tool for me. And when I press H, it selects the View tool. Now look closely at some of these icons, and you'll notice there's a small grey triangle in the bottom right. This tells us that there are multiple tools grouped together in this position of the toolbar. When I click the grey triangle, it expands to display the other tools in that group. I can then click the tool that I want to use. Whilst there are a lot of tools in the toolbar, there's only a few you use on a regular basis. The rest are useful, but it's better to learn the others when you need to use them rather than trying to remember everything now. Let's look at some of the most used tools, starting with the View tool. When I move my mouse pointer over the image with the View tool selected, you'll see the pointer change to a hand. I can then click on the image and drag to reposition it on the screen. You might wonder why we want to do this, but it makes more sense if we enlarge the image to 100% magnification. Now we can use the Move tool to reposition the visible area of the image on the screen. Incidentally, a great shortcut to fit the image to the available preview area is to double-click the background layer in the Layers Studio panel. The next tool we want to look at is the Move tool. This is a great tool for selecting objects and then resizing and repositioning them in the image. When I select the tool, you see a blue box appear around the image with small crosses in the corners and along the edges. These crosses are the drag handles which we can use to resize the object. When they appear as a cross, it means they're locked and we can't change them. As I have the background layer selected with the tool, if you look in the Layer Studio panel, you can see the lock. There's a small grey padlock icon on the layer. When I click it, it unlocks the layer and the crosses change to circles. Now I can resize the background layer by clicking and dragging the handles. I can also click and drag the object to reposition it on the document. Let's undo that now, and I'll lock the layer again with the lock option in the Studio panel. Our next tool is the Crop tool, which we can use to remove or crop out part of the image. When I click the tool, you'll see a crop overlay appear on the screen, which we can use to select part of the image. For example, you can see a couple of photographers standing on the rocks to the right of the screen. By clicking and dragging the edges of the crop overlay, I can cut them out of the frame. Then I can click the Apply button to make the crop. Now, one of the great things about the crop tool in the photo persona is that it's non-destructive. Watch what happens when I click the crop tool again. As before, you see the crop overlay, but you don't see the missing area of the image that was removed. That is, unless I click the reveal option. This shows the area that was previously removed by the crop tool so that I can resize the crop area to include it again. There are other things you can do with the crop tool as well, but we don't have time to cover them here. If you want to know more about how to use the crop tool, I'll include a link to another of my videos in the YouTube information below. The next tool to discuss is the paintbrush, which we use in a lot of photo editing. In fact, Affinity Photo has several brush-based tools which all have similar controls to the paintbrush. When you learn how to control the paintbrush, you also learn how to control these other brush tools. After clicking the paintbrush icon, you can see its controls appear in the toolbar along the top of the interface. These controls allow you to change brush characteristics, like the size of the brush, as well as the opacity, flow and hardness. Now notice that when I move my mouse pointer over the image, it shows a preview of what would happen if I clicked with the mouse. Then, if I don't move my mouse for a couple of seconds, the preview vanishes. This is a feature that you can turn on and off in the Affinity Photo preferences, so your brush may not do this. To demonstrate the brush, let me first add a new empty layer to the image by selecting the layer menu and then new layer. You can see the new layer appear in the Layers Studio panel. In this example, you can see that the layer has been selected because it's highlighted in blue. If another layer was selected instead, I would need to click the new layer because I want to paint onto it using the brush tool. Watch what happens now when I click and drag with my mouse. Notice I'm painting a line that's hiding the image below it. The line also has a hard edge to it. This hard edge is controlled by the hardness setting, which is currently set to 100%. If I change that to 50% and draw another line, you'll see that it has a softer edge. Then if I change it to 0%, you'll see the line becomes even softer. Also notice that this softening of the edge causes the line to become thinner, even though I've not changed the width of the brush. If you find you want to change the width of the brush, you can either use the width slider in the toolbar or use the square bracket keys on your keyboard. I prefer to use the square bracket keys because you can see the brush size respond. Press the left square bracket to make the brush smaller and the right square bracket to make it larger. Now let's look at the opacity and flow settings in the toolbar. So far, I've been painting with these set to 100%, but watch what happens when I set the flow to 10% to paint a line. The line appears to be transparent so that you can see the image below it. Then as I paint backwards and forwards over the same area, the strength of the line builds up until it's as dark as before. Let's now set the flow to 100% and the opacity to 10%. As before, when I paint a line, you can see the background image. But this time, if I paint backwards and forwards over the same area, the strength of the line doesn't change. This is the difference between using opacity and flow. The flow continues to build up as you move the brush over the same area. With the opacity, there isn't any build-up in the paint. It's only when I release the mouse button and then click and paint a second time that we see the density of the paint increase. I'll just set the opacity and flow back to 100% now because I want to show you how to change the paint colour. One way to do this is in the Swatches Studio panel, where you can select one of the colour options in the drop-down. Now I can click the colour that I want to select to use with the paintbrush. Another way to change the colour is using the Colours Studio panel. Here we can dial in the colour using the RGB sliders. For example, I can create the strongest possible red by setting the red slider value to 255 and then the green and blue sliders to have values of 0. It's also possible your Colour Studio panel doesn't look like mine. That's because you can change it to use different controls, like the colour wheel. Using the wheel, you can rotate the marker to pick the colour that you want to use. You can then move the second pointer inside the triangle to change the saturation and luminance of the colour. Now, although I've painted lots of lines, I haven't damaged the original image because I've been painting onto the layer I added. This allows me to hide the layer by clicking the visibility tick mark, which hides the lines. If I painted directly onto the background layer, it would have been a destructive edit because I would have changed the image pixels. Instead, I can now remove the lines by hiding them or even by deleting the layer. Now let's look at a couple of tools you can use to hide or remove unwanted objects in an image. These are the clone brush tool and the healing brush. As with the paintbrush tools, these are destructive tools that change the pixels of an image. This means we should always work with them on a new layer, like with the paintbrush tool. As before, I'll start by adding a new empty layer using the Layers menu and then the New Layer option. Now let's zoom into the area where we see the two photographers standing on the rocks. I'll start by selecting the clone brush tool. You can use this to copy from one area of an image and paint that onto another area. But before I try to use it, I need to change the option in the toolbar dropdown to be current layer and below. This means the brush will copy from all the layers in the image and not just the one that I have selected in the Layer Studio panel. We'll go more in depth on layers in a later lesson, but for now, just be sure that it's set to current layer and below. The next step is to pick the area I want to sample by positioning my brush over it. I then set the sample point by clicking with my mouse whilst holding down the Option key on my keyboard. If you're using a Windows PC, that's your Alt key. After setting the sample point, I move the brush to where I want to copy the sample to. In this example, it's over one of the photographers. As I do this, you can see a preview of what will be copied, which helps you to line it up with the other detail in that area. Then when I click, I can paint in the change. I can then repeat the process by sampling another area and painting that over other areas of the photograph. The problem with this repair though is that you can see the edges of the cloned area. One way around this might be to use a softer edge to the brush. Just as with the paintbrush tool we looked at earlier, you can change the hardness setting for the brush, which helps to blend your changes. Another option is to switch to using the healing brush tool. This works very much like the clone brush, except that it tries to blend the area you copy with the new area. As before, I need to set the brush to work with the current layer and below. I can then sample a point in the same way as I did with the clone tool and use it to paint over the area I want to repair. With a couple of carefully chosen samples, I can blend the repair into the image. Then when I zoom out, you can't see the areas even being repaired. But if I hide the layer where I made the repair to, you can see the photographers again. Now please don't forget to subscribe so that you don't miss future videos in this course. If the next video's already been published, you'll see it here now and you should watch that next. If not, watch this video where I remove unwanted objects from a photo. It's surprising what you can achieve using a couple of simple tools. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.